So, Amrita Shah, pleasure to meet you after such a long time. Let's just start off with a very odd question for you. In connection with early developments of rocketry in India, have you come across a guy called Stephen Smith?
I'm afraid not, no.
I've been asking all the scientists in ISRO, and many people haven't. He did some early testing of solid fuel rockets back in the 1935, 36, 37. Uh-huh. Very basic, uh-huh. But I thought I'd just throw it past you. So, you don't have a particular interest in space or technology, which maybe you can correct me on, but what motivated you to write Vikram Sarabhai, A Life, a biography on Vikram Sarabhai?
Yes, you're right. I can't say that I have any sort of great interest in space, though I did get interested once I started looking at it. And of course, one has grown up in the 60s, so one has sort of heard about space. But my interest in Dr. Sarabhai was through television. I mean, I had done a book earlier called Hype, Hypocrisy and Television in Urban India. And I was, if you read about the history of television in India, then you come across Vikram Sarabhai's name in every possible way. He was very keen on bringing television to India. He thought it could be used for development. So his idea, both in terms of hardware and in terms of content and what it could be used for, was a very important and significant influence in the early days of television. So that was what kind of led me to be interested in him.
And as a journalist, columnist and author writing for a national Indian press, writing about hard-hitting social issues, how come you ended up with, was your angle coming from a social impact of what Vikram Sarabhai had initiated?
I guess it was a mix of things. Firstly, really, I think that there's a lot of modern Indian history that's just not been written. And I think he was a really important figure, but there was nothing to read on him. I was astounded, actually, by the fact that my curiosity, really, I wanted to read about him. Uh-huh. So I just thought I could walk into a bookshop and buy a book. And I was so amazed to know that there was no biography. So I guess, in a sense, my interest in reading about him, and then that not being satisfied, right, was one reason. So my interest in, let's say, in documenting modern Indian history is one of the reasons. I can't say that it was the social impact of his work as much as his thinking. I was very intrigued by his mind, and the ideas he had. I mean, he was a scientist and someone who was sort of, into technology. And yet he had very clear ideas about the ethical dimensions, about the impact. And that interested me very much. I think we live in a society where there's too much sort of division. And I was interested in a sort of holistic idea.
Yes, his focus was on national development, equally, yes, amongst Indians. So, it was a very thorough, detailed book. How long did it take you to write, and what sort of research was involved?
About 3 years.
3 years?
Yes.
Vikram's hometown is in Ahmedabad. Mm-hmm. You obviously went there. Where else did your research take you?
I went to Trivandrum and to Tumba. I went to Delhi, of course. Baroda, where he had pharmaceutical concern, which he worked with. Where else did I go? I mean, I live in Mumbai, so, and he was heading the atomic energy program there, so that helped. I would have liked very much to have gone to Cambridge. I would have liked very much to go to MIT, but unfortunately, I did not have the resources to do all that.
So, writing a biography is very deep personal insight into an individual's life. Was there one thing in his life that you found surprising as an end product of your research in your book? That you weren't expecting, maybe?
Not really. I mean, I think everything in that sense is a sort of discovery because, you know, he died 30 years before I was writing the book. And I mean, I was very young when he died, so it's not as if, and he's, for some strange reason, I mean, that was another thing that bothered me. When I said I was curious about, you know, about knowing more about him and I couldn't find a biography, I also went back and looked at a lot of books about India. And I would kind of go through the index and try to find his name, and it just wasn't there. So that was, so, you know, so what it wasn't like one had known a lot about him. I had a sense of him, but I didn't really. So I can say a lot of things. I can't say they surprised me, but they were fun to kind of discover that he had been involved in a whole lot of things, including, you know, this detergent. Powder, right. Which I remember the advertisement very clearly, a very shrill advertisement from my childhood. Uh-huh. But you know, so these are little connections that, and then to know, for instance, that he started the first market research agency in India.
Yeah.
You know, it's sort of these were.
And this is all in the 50s and 60s, where,
yes.
And there's a tradition of his family to do that. You met his widow,
yes.
Rinalini Sarabhai. Mm-hmm. When you approached her first, with the idea of writing this biography, do you remember her response? Did she welcome it?
I met his daughter, and the same afternoon I met his son, uh-huh. and I think I met Rinalini probably a little later. Uh-huh. No, the family was very welcoming, and they were kind of very happy with the idea. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, though, they didn't seem to have too many resources to share.
Right.
So that was a bit of a blow because, right. you know, I had assumed that there would be all this material, and really there didn't seem to be that, really didn't seem to be much. So that was a bit disappointing for me, a little hard, but.
And being one of the strangest things that I found in the book was this relationship that Vikram had with his mistress Kamala Chowdhury. Mm-hmm. It's very open. That was the mm-hmm. unusual yes. thing that I found. Did you approach her as well, his mistress, and was she also
yes.
supportive of you writing this biography?
So I met her in Delhi. I just called her or emailed her, I don't remember which, uh-huh. and went across to meet her. Mm-hmm. And the first meeting, she started by telling me that she would have to know me to be able to talk.
Right.
And I said, certainly, I understand that. And so she started telling me a bit about herself.
Mm-hmm.
And then while she was doing that, she just started talking about the relationship and about Vikram Sarabhai and, you know, and various things. And it was a very intense interview. But that was the only interview because, you know, I think she just talked and then she kind of seemed to close up, unfortunately.
Right.
So after that I tried, I wrote to her and I said I understand that this is all very, very personal uh-huh. and I'm willing to, if you'd like, come and just talk.
Uh-huh.
Let's get to know each other a bit. I can send you my work to see what, you know. But we never got to talk after that. And she died pretty soon after, she passed away.
And immediately after, or the period after Vikram Sarabhai's death, do you know if his widow and his mistress, who were friends mm-hmm. well before they met Vikram, right. did they still keep in touch?
My sense is that they did have contact, yes.
Would that be perhaps the most difficult element of your research in writing the book, or was there something else that...
I think it was, it was a challenge for me to try and understand what had happened, or, you know, try and understand the sensibilities of each of the parties. Mm-hmm. But I think the real challenge was to try and write it in a way that was not, not in any way, I wanted to be sensitive. And I think I also wanted to be respectful of all parties involved because I did not think it was something to be sensationalized or it was, a lot of things happen in life that are difficult to explain. And I think that was important for me to try and get it right. And Mrs. Sarabhai did tell me that she appreciated the way I had handled the book.
Oh, yeah.
So I hope that I did it justice.
Really good. So, in the final book, was there anything that you would like to have included but for some reason weren't able to?
Perhaps maybe if I had...
That's okay.
Perhaps if I'd had more time, more resources, oh, I don't know. Uh-huh. You know, also, uh-huh. Well, let me also say, you see, it was the first biography, the first mm-hmm. full-fledged biography. So I had to do certain things, try to write for the layperson as well as the specialist. I had to take care of a lot of things. But I think, you know, in hindsight, I would have liked to have somehow placed him better in the history of science, maybe. I don't know. Perhaps because I've been later on reading a lot about it and meeting people who... So, but you know, maybe not. Maybe I just... Because the book wasn't meant for scientists alone. Right. It was meant for everyone, really, the general reading public.
Vikram Sarabhai died suddenly in his sleep in the end of 1971. Aged only 52. In your book, you described that when he died, he was reading a book. Do you know what the title of that book was?
I wish.
The Indian space program that he initiated in many ways is now almost 50 years old. How would you assess his initial ambitions of the social development to come out of the space program? Meteorology, education, telemedicine, hazard alerts, phishing, and so on. To what extent has his vision been implemented, do you think?
I must say I'm not an expert on the space program, so I this is not an expert answer at all. Mm-hmm. But from what I read, books like Touching Lives and so on and so forth, I know that they've been written by people associated with the space program, so I don't know if it's a...
Right.
But it seems to me, and from what I read about the success of the program, for instance, in weather mapping, remote sensing, it seems to have done well. That's the only way I can put it. You know, I'm not not really in a position to assess it, I think.
And say, nearly 50 years on, the Indian space program has matured. And the initial objective, Vikram's, for national development isn't the only objective. Now you have military, commercial and scientific elements mm-hmm. in there as well. Do you think that was inevitable, that this program would take that direction?
I don't think it was inevitable. Right. I don't think so, definitely not. I think... In a sense, it seems to me, and I may be wrong really, it seems to me to kind of reflect at least the sort of rhetoric that one hears, or the kind of image that the space program seems to have now, or the space it occupies in people's minds through the media, or through pronouncements, official pronouncements, is somewhat more flamboyant, more aggressive. Now, again, I may be wrong that that's not what's actually happening. But this is a sort of profile it has come to occupy, at least right now.
Right.
And to me, it seems to sort of perhaps reflect India as it is right now, trying to assert itself globally as a sort of economic, more as an economic powerhouse or place of opportunity. I don't know.
Right.
So I don't think that was intended, because everything Sarabhai said at the time was very much to kind of have a more modest, a more...
And he has, he holds a very unique place in Indian history, let alone the space program. And finally, it's been 5 years since you wrote your Vikram Sarabhai A Life biography. Do you have any plans for further editions? Maybe an e-book?
Yes, possibly. I would be... talking to the publishers now, and let's see what we can do. I really think that this is a book that needs to be read widely, particularly by young people. I think he was a very inspiring person. In everyone I met, when I was doing the book to interview them about grown-up people. I mean, they cried, you know? So I think he really had done, and a lot of people, every person seemed to kind of suggest that he touched their lives in a way that was somehow magical. And so, you know, I think that, if you know, one could spread that effect, that'd be wonderful.
Amrita Shah, thank you very much indeed for your time.
Thank you so much.